Hello, and welcome to the first program from the new closed-circuit television service. It's about your own town, London, and I'm your presenter, Anne Dickinson. We'll be looking around London, and we hope the programs will interest you and that you'll want to go and visit the places for yourself, not only in the centre of London, but near your own homes too. But where shall we start? Because London is big. I know. Long before there were any houses or shops, the River Thames still flowed through London. So we'll start with the river. And the bridge you all know? Yes, Tower Bridge. And if we want any special photographs or films, well then we'll ask Alan to come along and he'll take photographs of them.
Hello.
Things like Tower Bridge, for instance.
Focus. Check exposure. Line up the shot.
What does the bridge remind you of? Two castle towers with drawbridges between them. Drawbridges which lift up. From the outside, Tower Bridge would fool anybody. It looks so old. But it isn't, you know. It isn't even 100 years since it was built. Only 80. But it's not all pretend. Inside that fairy tale stonework are great steel girders, which do the real work of holding the bridge up. The steel towers rise from stone foundations called piers in the river. The road is carried over shore spans and suspended on steel chains. Then over two bascules, which have safety locking devices where they meet. Look, there are the steel chains. And the steel towers. They're encased in Portland stone and granite so that they fit in with the buildings that are nearabouts. At the moment, the traffic's passing over fairly freely. This coke heats these large boilers that supply steam to the pump room. The steam then drives this great pump wheel. Which works the engines in the main tower. This must give the engines enough push or hydraulic pressure to lift the bascules. Each bascule weighs over 1,000 tons and has its own machinery inside the pier. This machinery rotates the bascules, like this. When a ship wants to pass through Tower Bridge, she must sound a warning on her siren. If it's during the daytime, she must fly a flag called a ball and pennant. And if it's at night, she must have two red lights. Then the lookout on Tower Bridge rings the warning bells. Then the traffic stopped, and these special policemen take charge. They're closing the gates that will stop the traffic from going across. Here the bridge driver throws a lever to unlock the bolts of the bascules and turns a wheel to release the power to the engines. There are the bascules going up slowly. The pump wheel turns faster as the hydraulic pressure is maintained. The heavy bascules lift up and up. Almost there now. And if you watch on the right, You'll see the river signal raised. This means the ship may safely come through. We'll watch now from the river. Here she comes, assisted by powerful tugboats. Now the bridge driver in his cabin puts everything into reverse. The bascules are lowered. You can see them through the window. And the river signal is dropped so that the traffic can flow once more over the bridge. Today, we'll follow a ship through Tower Bridge. It goes there about once every fortnight, usually on a Sunday. It's the Baltic Star, and a cargo vessel, which means she was built to carry goods from one place to another. She can also carry a few passengers, maybe 7 or 8. Her superstructure is white, and her hull, grey. Her boot topping, or band of colour, is green, and her underside, black. Her fortnightly run is between Poland and England. If she leaves Gdynia in Poland at 11 o'clock on Thursday night, she reaches Kiel at 11 o'clock on Friday night. She sails through the Kiel Canal and across the North Sea. By 4 o'clock, and that's very early on Sunday morning, she's passing the pilot vessel off the east coast. By 8, she's at Gravesend. She proceeds up the river, turns to pass under Tower Bridge backwards, and berths at Mark Brown's Wharf by 10 o'clock on Sunday morning. Now, the captain is master of the ship, but it's usually the first mate who has to take control of the cargo. The first mate of the Baltic Sun is Mr. Chippendale. Mr. Bromley is in charge of Mark Brown's Wharf and the unloading of the cargo there. So on Monday morning, the Baltic Sun's waiting at the wharf. If you look closely, you'll see that the crew have already removed some of the hatches. Mr. Bromley leaves his office and makes his way over to the Baltic Sun. He's got the cargo list in his hand. You see, it's still fairly early. There you can see the hatches open. And into Mr. Chippendale's office. They discuss the goods the ship's carrying, and Mr. Chippendale gives Mr. Bromley a copy of the cargo plan. We've made the plan more simple so that you can see clearly what the Baltic Sun has brought from Poland on this trip. On deck are refrigerated containers. There are 5 hatchways to the holds underneath, and some of these are refrigerated. So, working as seamen would say, from fore to aft, we have general cargo, buckets and baskets, eggs, wood wool for Canada, sodium sulfite, chairs, textiles, bacon, meat in tins, jam and butter, cheese, beef, ducks, more bacon and meat, and general cargo, again. This might be glassware, brushes or brooms. Some people call the Baltic Sun and her sister ship breakfast boats. Can you see anything here that you might have for your breakfast. Now the cargo must be unloaded. And these tall cranes behind me here do most of the work. The first things to be lifted off are the refrigerated containers full of beef. They're unloaded straight onto lorries and carried away to the meat market at Smithfield's. Lighters, or barges, will take the goods, like wood wool, to other ships and warehouses along the river. The cranes swing the bacon straight into the loopholes of the warehouse. And lorries will later carry it away. Small forklift trucks carry loads like eggs about the wharf and in and out of the warehouses. Now let's watch the work in progress. If you look carefully, you'll see hooks like this being used by the workmen. Of course, they don't use them for everything. It's no good hooking it into anything that's fragile, but you'll see how useful it is with things that are covered in sacking. At the wharf, the men gather near the labour office to collect their work cards and to find out about their jobs for the day. They work in groups or gangs, and each man knows exactly what he has to do. They're called dockers or wharfmen if they work on the wharf. Here they are doing quite a tricky job, manoeuvring a container. They're swinging it round. And there's the crane driver, Bill Dennis. Now he's carefully edging it onto a lorry so that it can be taken straight away from the wharf. This is wood wool, and it's being swung onto the waiting lighters. The lightermen will take it downriver to ships that are bound for Canada. Eggs are loaded much more gently than this, with the forklift. They're put onto lorries bound for shops and supermarkets in London. Now bacon is being swung over from the ship to the loophole. And now pulled inside. Here's some more coming up from the hold of the ship. Over it goes. And into the loophole. These men are using the same kind of hooks as the one I showed earlier. And that's because if they didn't use the hooks, the rough sacking round the bacon and the freezing cold would soon make their hands chapped and sore. Four sides of bacon on each bundle or bale slide down the conveyor onto the waiting trolley. Every man has his own job, and he doesn't do anything else. Notice the men are wearing coats. That's because the bacon travelled in refrigerated holds. And the warehouse is chilled. Now it's stored into piles, but not for long. Here it is being stacked up again. And taken away across the warehouse to the other side. Out of a loophole at the far side of the warehouse and stacked onto a lorry. It's covered and tied down and then driven away from the wharf along the narrow streets between the warehouse and the offices. This street is called Potter's Fields. Out of Potter's Field into Tooley Street, and then to pork factories, shops, and supermarkets all over London. Well, our story's finished for today. But I hope you'll come to the wharf and you'll see the ships and the dockers working for yourself. If you do, you'll find out that lots of the cargo carried by ships is very different from the ones we've seen today. Oh, and keep a lookout for some of the Polish goods that we've mentioned today too, won't you? In 2 weeks' time, we'll be exploring London again together. But until then, goodbye.